like Dr. Phil here and Marcus Welty, and then everybody got well. But the situation I was in, taking care of 5,000 sugar plantation patients, is most of them are pretty healthy, but the ones that were sick, chronically ill, never got well. No matter how hard I tried, no matter how many pills I pushed, even after I sent them off to very big surgeries, they just never got well. And I took it personally. I took it as a fault of mine. I didn't think I was a very good doctor. So after 3 years of that kind of experience with folks like you, with chronic problems, I mean, this looks like a pretty healthy group, but other folks out there in the world are trying to take care of chronic obesity, chronic indigestion, chronic heart disease, chronic constipation, chronic cancer problems, chronic arthritis. Never seen anybody get better. I finally came to the realization that the system doesn't work. That amazes me. Here I am, almost 40 years later, still practicing medicine in the same setting that I was in 40 years ago, and nothing's changed. There are just more fat, sick people being treated by doctors who make no difference at all in their care. It's a sad situation. Well, we're going to have a... What do you think? Anyway, that's one of the things I learned, is I learned my low capacity, my ineffectiveness as a physician being a plantation doctor taking care of these 5,000 people. But the other thing I learned was how people cheat. Yeah. I don't think I could have learned that anyplace else but the first generation, and hardly anybody sees that anymore. Some people remember that. The first generation of Filipinos, Japanese, Chinese who moved from their native lands to the Big Island and started families. The first generation learned a diet of rice, mostly rice. But they could, okay, rice and vegetables, and they got lucky with their lion, they had a little fish once in a while, and if they got unlucky at the cockfight, they had a little chicken once in a while. But otherwise, their diet was rice and vegetables, and that was the first generation. And then the second generation, they got a chance to eat a little bit of richer foods. Where we lived in Honokaa, we had something called, a place called Texas Drive, the home of the Malasada. And that was about all there was in terms of rich foods. But the second generation managed to get up, you know, Texas Drive, to get up there. And then in 1974, this was 1973, we first moved there. In 1974, the first McDonald's came to Hilo. I was one of their first and best customers. and progress continues to be made, and as progress in terms of efficiently distributing food to people, the result is obvious. People are getting fatter and sicker. We still have a unique opportunity to see this if we happen to be from a place like Hawaii. I just had dinner with Senator Mike Abbott, and we talked about this, about Hawaii could still be a place for change, because people remember when not everybody was sick and fat. People remember the days when grandma and grandpa, first generation Japanese, Filipinos, and Chinese, everybody was trapped. They had no heart disease, no breast cancer. And, maybe you remember your parents or grandparents who were essentially immune to diseases that are epidemic, not just in the parents, but in the children. And so I was talking to the senator, and I told him, you know, this is still a place where we can make some big changes, because people do have the basic knowledge that it doesn't have to be the way it is. There was a time when people enjoyed excellent health, and there is a reason why they enjoyed excellent health. Which brings me to my presentation. I've written, Mary and I together have written 12 national best-selling books. And we've written enough words, plenty of words. And I said I would never write another book again. So last June, we were in Costa Rica with a group of people. We go on expansion trips. In fact, that's the reason we're over here now, is we're bringing a group of people to Kauai for an adventure trip this January. We took our group to the Big Island last year, and the Big Island the year before. We take groups of people on trips to different places. Like Costa Rica's been a very popular destination for us. And we were with about 150 people in Costa Rica last summer, and it gives me a little extra time to think when we're on these trips. And I thought to myself, I've got to do something to better communicate to people what I believe and allow them to change more easily, and I just can't do it with words. And people I work with would tell me, well, people don't read words anymore, they have these devices and they just look at pictures. So I said, okay, what I'll do is I'll put together a picture book. So in June 2014, I put together Dr. McDougall's color picture book on food poisoning and how to cure it by eating beans, corn, potatoes, and rice. And this color picture book is on my website. It's free. It's in 22 languages. And I'll go through the color picture book with you over the next few minutes. The first thing I did with this color picture book is I took it home for grandkids who were 10, 8, and 6 at that time. And I went through the color picture book with them, and I said, asking these young boys if they could understand this. And I said, yeah, Grandpa, we understand. And I asked them if they understood the universal signs for go and caution and stop, you know, traffic light signs. They said, yeah, Grandpa, we understand this. And I said, well, if you young boys understand this, then everybody ought to be able to understand it. It's on my website. It's a 66-page color picture book. So I put this together last June, and it's really where my heart's been ever since then. In January of this year, I'll tell you the name of the company, because it's a deal signed. HarperCollins came to us, a big publishing company, and they offered us what you'd consider a big bucket of money. Write another book, and Mary and I thought about it a little bit to write another word book, and it just didn't seem like what we really wanted to do was write another word book. And the money wasn't, it was a large amount of money, but it wasn't a motivating factor. So we kept putting them off, and I said, you know what I really want to do is I want to publish Dr. McDougall's color picture book on food poisoning. Well, this went on until a couple of months ago, and they finally came back to me and they said, okay, what we'd like to do is publish Dr. McDougall's color picture book as a standalone centerpiece, and you can put words on either side for us. I said, okay, I'll do that. So we signed the contract last week. But the most important thing that I have as a communication tool is this color picture book, and it's in 22 languages on my website. Everything's free. Pretty much everything's free on the website. So let me go through with you the color picture book. If we can get going, help me out.